To watch more Bhagavad Gita discourse videos, subscribe to our YouTube channel. It was the mind of Arjuna that got deluded. Now what Krishna did was, he elevated Arjuna from the mind, that emotional sensibility level. He elevated him to the level of the intelligence. I don't know whether you have ever thought about it. Mind is an internal instrument in us. It is not visible. You can feel it, that's all. In order to bring about reformation, refinement, changes or moderation, any kind of an embellishment in the mind, intelligence is the only faculty that you have. How many times shall I repeat this statement? All of you are discussing about the problems of the mind, but none of you apparently knows that intelligence is the only factor which can act upon the mind and make it function the way we want. And there must be a constant interaction between the intelligence and the mind. Even the Bhagavad Gita dialogue, I can say, is actually a dialogue between the enlightened intelligence of Krishna and the deluded mind of Arjuna. Arjuna could not think and reason properly. Krishna took up the cause. And he started presenting introspections to Arjuna. So he picked it up, the intelligence picked it up, and the intelligence started interacting with the mind. After the first admonition that Krishna gave, suddenly the tears of Arjuna dried up. And in place of a worried and an emotionally stressed person, he became a logical, rational, spiritual and philosophical inquirer. See the transition, the transformation. If your intelligence begins to introspect over the problem that you have, the problem is invariably in the mind, and the solution has to be found by the intelligence. So this is very, very important. All of you should know it well. How Arjuna responds? Yesterday I said, the introductory part is over. What is the central theme in Bhagavad Gita? The central theme is to provide the soul focus on the soul. Our whole life is an interaction. But the interactions are between the senses and the objects of the world. The interactions are in the sensory level. In the sensory level. And these interactions begin, once they begin, they have their impacts, they have their registrations to make in our system, and the further interactions are triggered on the basis of the interactional impacts we have. And thus our life becomes only outward and sensory. We have no time to employ the intelligence and address our own concerns of the mind, inquiries of the intelligence. If there are any questions from the ego of man, those questions also, we never take any time for it. That is our problem. If only you will spend half an hour or 40 minutes every day, where your intelligence will only address your mind, only be reflecting upon the mind's problems, mind's needs, mind's confrontations, let it be anything, but the concern is the mind's. So it's an inner concern that you have. So all our problems are ultimately a psycho-intellectual pursuit. Now what did Krishna say? Natve vaham jatunasam natvam neme janadhipaha nachaivana bhavishyamaha sarve vayamatavparam. Just see. Now let me ask you in a very simple manner. I delivered the message yesterday. All of you certainly heard. You are attentive. How many of you have done introspection over the message that you have received? You took the trouble of listening to me, and it was for your own purpose and your own objective. Having done so, were you faithful enough, fond enough, loving enough to do introspection over what you have heard? If you have done, I compliment you, bless you additionally. My blessings are otherwise, it is there for everybody. Have you done any introspection? What did I say? Natvevaham jatunasam. Every one of us, we say, I am living. I am. Where are you? I am here. Where were you? I was there. Where are you going to be? I shall be there. So a reference to our existence and presence is always there. There is no time in your life when you are becoming not present. You are always present. That means what? You are existence. 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 If I, every individual, is existing, can the existence become non-existent? Nor can it ever become different. A thing cannot change its original nature at all. So if you are existent, you will continue to exist, continue to exist. Now this is our focus. And are you existing in a changeful manner? No. The I in you, I showed you very clearly, has not changed at all. Now you tell me, you have a variable or a changeful existence in the bodily level, the biological aggregate called the body. There everything is changing. By I, you are not referring to it. You refer to your body as my body, mind as my mind, intelligence and as my intelligence, ego as my ego, your car as your car, your family members, your house, everything is yours, mine, mine, mine. The possessive case mind always makes a reference to the object. The subject is different. What is that subject? I is the subject. So tell me, what is your personality? Is it the object body and object elements, or is it the subject I? You have to say subject I. This subject I is existence, and as an existence, it never undergoes any change whatsoever. If I ask you, you say, I was not happy, now I am all right. I was miserable, thereafter I became all right. That means the I seems to be floating over everything, floating. In moments of grief, the I is floating in grief, thereafter it survives it and it becomes joyous. So every condition is undergone by it in a floating manner. Just like a boat will ply on the water, we are always remaining changeless. And we are gliding through the changefuls. Now this is the focus for you. Identify your personality as the I. Less than a year ago, we specially made a trip. Ma was with me. I made a trip to Lucknow to see a very ardent devotee of mine, Rakesh Mittal. He was an IAS officer, retired. He somehow fell a victim to this cancer. It was treated very effectively in Bombay. Everything was going on, and suddenly the reverse happened. So knowing that the last day has somehow had, was coming, I decided to go and see him. And you know the message I told him at last, Rakesh, listen to me. Remember what I say. Your body is a biological aggregate, and as a biological aggregate, it has got its own laws, rules, regulations, procedures, systems and whatnot. Leave the body to its plight. Understand that you are not the body. I am different from the body. The body is only mine. It is something like the house being repaired, the body being treated. So leave the body to its own plight and fate and remain different and detached. Always feel that I am different from. This is the only way the present situation can be properly handled. Have you understood me? I asked. He said, yes. Will you do it? Yes. That was the last meeting I had with him. I have given this message to several people. One of the questions they ask, we are losing our job, what can be done? There was a time when you gained a job. You were very much required in the United States and they wanted people to come from outside to have jobs. So this is an economic plight or an economic fate. After all, the world is passing through the corona episode, as I call it. You know, we don't have any memory of anything like this. Nobody has an experience to fall back upon. This is the first time perhaps that people are facing it in this manner. Now, this is not a creation of the human mind like war and destruction. This is something nature itself is instrumenting, has instrumented. We can do nothing about it, say nothing about it. But we can do something spiritually. You can do something with your mind, with your heart, with your will and wish. Don't think that it's a fight always in the bodily level. Let the body fight with its immunity. That's part of the nature system. But our nature has also given us the mind and the intelligence. You can use your mind and surround the corona. It is possible. This is what I wrote in a message to a number of people. And I asked them to chant the Mrityunjaya mantra. What is this mantra? Mantra is a mental formula. Mental formula to accomplish whatever you want. Whatever you want. One interesting person from Delhi telephoned me to say, Swamiji, I don't have enough of commitment. I don't have enough of enthusiasm to do what I want. So when he was speaking to me like that, okay, will you do what I ask you to do? He said, yes. Then go on saying, commitment. I want to be committed. I want to be committed. Go on saying thousands and thousands of times. After a few days, he says, Swamiji, I have become much more committed now. Tell me how this happened. Now he has started giving this message to the others also. And the other day we got down in the airport, and when we were coming out, he was introducing to a friend of his, and he said, Swamiji, this person is catching hold of gold every day, but all the other officers are not able to. It is only because of his integrity, commitment and dedication, about which I have told him. So he has become committed, dedicated, and he is a man of integrity. So he is able to somehow identify, here is the baggage which is going to be the culprit. I am just repeating what he told me. I don't have any comments at all. So there is a mental formula. All mantras are mental formulae. So you can let the body develop its own biological immunity. But we have psychology. We have a psychological product called the mind. We also have an intellectual product called the intelligence. We also have an assertional product called the ego. You can use all the three of them to tackle physical, material, objective situation. By its very nature, all people cannot take to it. That you and I should agree. People are mostly physical. They are physically born in this world. They physically interact in this world. So they only believe in medicines and things like that. I am not denying them. And I'm not decrying them also. They have their own place, but the mind has got the superior place. That you should understand. This is something very important. So that I factor, I am an existence. I am an existence. As an existence, I can never perish. I can never get transformed. That is why I continue to say, I am, I am. And put your focus on the I. Arjuna was told that all are transitions in the body. Death also is a transition. It doesn't mean any extinction or destruction. Then Arjuna thought, okay, I will never speak about death at all. I will not moan. My problem is our life itself. In the life, there are so many undulations, so many experiences which we don't like. Now, what is the way of tackling the so-called alternates of life? What shall I do? Then Krishna is giving an answer. I have explained it during the past 65 years from several numberless platforms. Many people have heard me nodding their head, but I don't know whether they have made use of the message. I will tell you also with a lot of additional and renewed hope and confidence. Krishna analyzes the entire life. If I ask you a question, can you tell me what is your life? I don't think anybody will answer. Most people say, Swamiji, I have never thought about what is life. We have never thought about what is life? Then how do you propose to live? If you wanted to become a mechanical engineer, what did you do? You learned mechanical engineering for about 4 or 5 years, maybe additionally 2 years. Then only you became an engineer. Similarly, where did you study about your life? After which, being enlightened and educated, you started living. We are never thinking or probing into our life with any sense of examination, analysis, and investigation. But we are doing a lot of scientific investigations into many things. Now, in this corona confrontation, has anybody thought about how we can develop our immunity using our inner resources, namely the mind and the intelligence? Nobody has tried. People like us believe more in the inner resources than in the external resource. The inner resources are held by our mind and intelligence. We are wanting all of you to develop your own inner resources. Inner resources held by MIND, mind and intelligence. So Krishna is discussing life. And you know, in 4 letters he has defined the whole of our life. Matrasparshastu kaunteya shitoshna sukadukhadaha agamapayinaha anityaha tantidikshasvabharada. Matrasparshastu kaunteya. O son of Kunti, Kunti Putra, matrasparshaha. Our life is constantly an interacting between the senses which are fixed on your body and the objects of the world which are distributed around. Every time it is an interaction between the senses in us, in the individual, and the objects around him. We have altogether 5 senses. Eyes to see, ears to hear, nose to smell, tongue to taste, and skin to touch. Even if you have one of the senses, there will be interaction in life. If all the 5 senses become defunct, then you cannot have any interaction. So our life is always an interaction between the senses and the objects. The objects are many, infinite. But the senses are only 5. Though we call it interaction, don't think that the objects and the senses have equal place in this interaction. Our senses are 5. They are animate. Our senses and the body are animated by the mind, by the spirit within. So they are animated. But the objects of the world are not so generally, except the living beings and plants. So our senses always have a plus factor with them. They are superior to the objects. The interactions are taking place because of the senses, not because of the objects. Suppose so many colorful things are around you. If you decide not to open your eyes, none of them can be and will be seen. The objects cannot force themselves upon the senses. It is the senses that initiate the interaction. I wanted to see, so I open my eyes and I fix it in the direction I want, where I want to see. So the whole process is mostly sense-based. The objects are present there, so to say, that's all. So life is an interaction. In the interaction, the senses in our body continue to interact with the objects of the world. When this interaction takes place, are you with me? When this interaction takes place, the interaction has got its own resultant or outcome. When the eyes see an object and they find it to be particularly colorful and shaped, when the eyes are seeing an object, that seeing does not stop in seeing. It produces an outcome. This outcome is not in the sensory level or bodily level. The outcome is in the mind level. Mind is always a seat of emotions. So what happens? Every sensory interaction brings about the resultant called sukha, happiness, or dukkha, unhappiness. One of the two. Not both together. Either it will be happiness or it will be unhappiness. And this results whenever there is an interaction between the senses and the objects. What do you understand from this? As long as you have the senses in you and the objects also are there in the world, repeated interactions between the senses and the objects will take place and repeated sukha-dukhas also will surge forth. If you are living, you are bound to have interactions with the objects. And as long as you have interactions with the objects, you are bound to have sukha-dukhas one after the other. Tell me now, are sukha-dukhas your creation? I hope you will understand what I say and you will talk intelligently. You should not be offended when I say, you should borrow intelligence and think. Do you have to work for sukha and dukkha is my question. Neither for sukha nor for dukkha you have to work and strive. They are an outcome, an inevitable outcome of the sense-object interaction. And one after the other will take place. So what do we have to do in life? Nothing. Go on living, go on interacting with the objects. Proceed with your activity, proceed with your interaction, do whatever is necessary, but understand that all these interactional impacts will be in the way of a sukha or a dukkha. 50% is sukha, only 50% is dukkha. Generally, we are not bothered about our sukha. We are only displeased with our dukkha. So 50% of our life is already successful. The rest of the 50%, what should be done? Krishna says, agama apayinaha anityaha. These sukha-dukhas are by their very nature coming and going. If you expect them not to come and not to go, it will never be. They are by their very nature occurring and disappearing. They will prevail and then subside, emerge and subside. That is the nature of sukha-dukhas. If it is so, you understand them, assess them to be so. Agama apayinaha anityaha. They are not eternal at all. They don't have any power to last. So they will not last at all. They will only be transitory. Even sukhas and dukhas, dukhas and sukhas, both of them alike, if they are transitory, would you like to have them at all? No. No. They are transitory. Because they are transitory, what do you have to do? Tanti dikshasva. Forbear them. Forbear what? Only dukkha. Sukha you already like, so there is no forbearance there. Now this forbearance you can cultivate in your mind by your intelligence, by understanding and evaluating matters in this manner. Enlightenment is the greatest persuasion, is the greatest everything in human life. So what is Krishna doing? Employing the tool of intelligence, activating Arjuna's intellect, he is trying to make him understand that whatever dukkha he is suffering from, that dukkha is not worth bothering about. Tan tidikshasva. You know, sukha-dukkhas are alternating, I said. What does it mean? Don't stop thinking. Think well. Whenever there are interactions between the senses and the objects, either there will be sukha or there will be dukkha, I said. So if sukha and dukkha, what is? How do you understand them? They are one opposed to the other. Like cold and heat. Shidoshna sukha dukkada. In the physical and skin level, cold and heat are opposed to each other. In the same manner, in the mind level, sukha and dukkha are opposed to each other. Though they are opposed to each other, they are complementary to each other. What is meant by complementariness? Without sukha, you cannot have the taste or experience of dukkha. And without dukkha, you cannot have the taste or experience of sukha. So dukkha is necessary to experience sukha, and sukha is necessary to experience dukkha. So what is sukha? The absence of dukkha. So if you experience sukha, it necessarily means that you had dukkha. That dukkha was terminated, it tapered off, and sukha appeared. So what brings you sukha? The previous dukkha. And what puts you to dukkha? It is again previous sukha. In the background of dukkha alone, sukha can be experienced. So what is your estimation about dukkha? Oh, dukkha has come. So surely I will have sukha also. So it is dukkha that brings sukha. So is dukkha a friend or a foe? You tell me now. Similarly, so far as sukha is concerned, I can have sukha only after dukkha. And this sukha will drive me again to dukkha. So if a person drives me to dukkha, if something drives me to dukkha, is it welcome? So sukha does not have that welcomeable feature in it. Dukkha does not have that hateable feature also in it. In as much as it brings sukha, it is welcome and it is befriending us. In as much as it pushes you to dukkha, the sukha is not so much of a friend. Where do you stand now? That is why he said, develop an attitude of indifference, an attitude of forbearance towards both. Tan titikshasva bharata. Arjuna was stunned. What? In the whole of life, mark my words, in the whole of life, the variegated world, the world of infinite variety and plurality, can only interact with the senses. The senses are five, so the interactions also are fivefold. The world may have infinite number of objects, but so far as you are concerned, they are only Shabda, Sparsha, Rasa, Rupa and Gandha. They are only sound, sight, smell, taste and touch. There is no sixth product in this world. So where is your variety of the world gone now? Answer me. Where is the variety? So the entire variegated world, the world of infinite variety, it is telescoped into five by our five senses. So are the senses powerful now? Or the objects powerful, you tell me. Imagine the small eyes that you have, but their range of perception is infinite. The far point of the eye is infinity. So please understand this point. You say life, 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 and you want to be many things in life. You may become many things, but the fact remains life is interactional, and you interact with only Shabda, Sparsha, Rasa, Rupa and Gandha. Whatever you may do, wherever you are, whichever may you be your lifestyle, married or unmarried, parents or no parents, it can only be this. So, Tanti Dikshasva. Now the question is, how to forbear it? That forbearance cultivation, he says, Yam hinavyatayandiyade purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram somradatvaya kalpade. Samadukha sukham dhiram somradatvaya kalpade. Bah. You have to develop an attitude of being at home with both sukha and dukha. When the sukha comes, be grateful to dukha, and when dukha comes, be complimenting it. Dukha brings sukha, and the sukha drives you to dukha. So, without unduly exulting over sukha and unduly getting aggrieved by dukha, have an attitude of indifference. Between the sukha and dukha, there is a kind of a line of distinction where you neither have sukha nor dukha. That is actually the expression of the self. Arthad arthantaram chitte yadi madhyetu yasthitihi nirastam ananakara sa swarupa sthiti smrita. This is from Yoga Vasishtha Ramayana. Our mind is like this in a plane. The sukha rises as a wave. Dukkha rises as another wave, like that. So the wave rises and it subsides. Then the next wave comes. So in between the two waves, arthad arthantaram chitte yadi madhyetu yasthitihi nirastamananakara. In that in-between state, there is neither sukha nor dukkha. You think about it. Think about it. Every time you think about it, you will find the impact of dukkha and sukha will grow lesser, lesser, and lesser. Lesser. See, this is a condition in the mind. That mind condition can be treated only by the intellectual penetration that you are able to make. So, when we go from sukha to dukkha, there is a nirastamananakara, sa swarupa sthiti smrita. That is the real state of the self. So the sukha-dukkhas are necessary in order to understand that there is something like an in-between presence called the self. Something in-between presence called the self. To understand it, sukha-dukkhas are necessary. So he says, yam hinavyatayandiyate purusham purusharshabha samadukha sukham dhiram somradatvaya kalpade. He who is able to pass through sukha-dukkhas, whose mind is not shaken, afflicted, tormented, confronted by any extent of sukha and dukkha, any extent of sukha and dukkha, that man is fit for liberation, he says. So our sadhana is in gliding through sukha-dukkhas. Let the external causes be anything, anything, anything. Ultimately they bestow only sukha-dukkhas. All the objects put together can create only sukha-dukkhas. So Krishna is providing a key for your life. What is that? The whole world with all its variety, variety, variety can bring about only sukha and dukkha in your life. And if you are able to evenize them in your mind, you have won over the world. Won over the world. The world may be anything, but they can produce only sukha dukkhas. And if you are able to meet them with this kind of an insight, you will find the world is won over. This is why Krishna says, ihaiva tairjita sargo yesham samye sthitam manah nirdosham hi samam brahma तस्मात् ब्रह्मणिते स्थिताः. Whoever is able to install Samya in the mind, and by virtue of the Samya, they are able to sublimate Sukha-Dukhas, they have won over the world. This is the full philosophy. After having exposed the self, he is now telling him how to find the self and to how to abide in the self.
Join our live event on the 10th, 11th and 12th of October 2020. Register at www.globalgita.org.